immediately crystal clear to the listener that this is what music is all about. And really, once you get off into this world of just intonation, it is very difficult to go back to equal temperament. Equal temperament has its place. It's created a great body of literature. We need it. It's a stepping stone. It's maybe a sidetrack, but it's important. But I think after people hear the well-tuned piano, and we are hoping to release yet another performance of this work, an even slightly longer one, one that's about 6 minutes longer, the last performance in this same series, this next year in 86 on Gramavision Records. Gramavision is extremely enthusiastic about releasing a five-record set in a box, as well as a set of five CDs and a set of cassettes, all simultaneously. You can choose your format. If you people who are interested in finding out more about this can write to Gramavision Records at 260 West Broadway, New York City, 10013, or to my own foundation, the Mela Foundation, M-E-L-A, which stands for Music Eternal Light Art. And this foundation is being established to promote the work of Lamont Young and Marian Zazeela and Pandit Pranat. The address of the Mela Foundation is 275 Church Street, New York, New York, 10013. So if you're interested in being put on a mailing list to hear about the records we're going to release, you can write to either one of those addresses and send your name. This
Let me jump in at this point, Lamont, while you take a short break there. In fact, I'd like to have some of that water too. Eventually, it's getting warm in the warm in our studio here. And let me direct a question to Marian. As Lamont indicated earlier, when he does a series of concert performances, live performances of the well-tuned piano, you're not just sitting in a concert hall with a piano up on the stage under a proscenium and the audience sitting in neat little rows watching a person play. That may be one way to play piano music, but Lamont's music doesn't really, I think, lend itself very much to that. What you do is you provide an entire light environment that goes along with it. In fact, it's an integral part of any given live performance of the piece.
That's right.
Tell us a little bit about how that, I know with the limitations of just audio, it's difficult to talk about what a light environment is going to be like. But give us a little bit of an indication of what you do to prepare such a light environment for a performance of well-tuned piano.
Well, let me describe a little bit the room that this performance was actually performed in, because it was... the situation that we had, this was as a project of the Dia Art Foundation in New York, which had provided a building for us to develop into what was hoped to be a permanent dream house, although it didn't turn out that way. And there was a space in that building that was 70 feet square with a 30-foot ceiling. It was the former trading floor of the New York Mercantile Exchange, so it was kind of like a big bank, you could say, or a big trading floor. And it was an almost 100-year-old building and had this very interesting size and space. And what I did was the ceiling consisted of six equally or almost equal quadrants that were approximately square. And I took the four outer ones and created a diagonal, which was bisected in each one in two equal places. And the work that I do with light involves the projection of colored shadows by placing forms, in this case, the mobiles that I created, in a particular position, and placing colored lamps in relation to them. A phenomenon occurs where the shadows of the mobiles are cast in different colors, depending on what colored lights are projected on
it's
them.
The complementary color of the light it's, that's being projected to
it
some extent.
Maybe there are some different factors that enter in, but in the case of the magenta lights, the two colors that are used in the lamps are a magenta and a deep blue. And so although magenta and blue are not complements, those are the only colors kind of available. And what happens is that as one light projects towards a mobile, a shadow has to be cast. Normally, if there were no other light present, the shadow would be black. But by placing, let's say, the blue light in proximity, oddly enough, that space that takes place that would have the black shadow gets filled in with this blue color. So a rather magical visual occurrence takes place, and it's a very complicated thing to set up, and that's why it takes so long, because everything has to be very precisely measured in order that the shadows line up in relation to the position of the mobiles. Now, in this large space, the light was such that the entire room was just bathed in a very congenial purplish magenta light, and the space was carpeted when the audience was in. And of course, many people did stay for 5 hours, but it was possible to come and go as necessary for people. They could lie down, and if they lay down and looked up, they would see this play of colored shadows on the ceiling and could study the symmetries that ensued. It's possible that a symmetry could take place around the entire room, but that would be a rare occurrence.
Let me ask Alex Dia, who is sitting very patiently right here next to me, about his participation in these live concert performances of the well-tuned piano. Alex, I understand you got started by helping Lamont out with the tuning of this piano. And perhaps you can tell, for those people in our audience who may not be familiar, if you're going to change the tuning of a piano from anything other than what it normally has been tuned to, which usually is equal temperament, the piano sometimes tends to resist. And it's a real problem to keep a piano tuned in an unusual tuning. In fact, usually if you tune it and then move it at all, you destroy the tuning. Is that not true?
That's true.
So what kind of problems did you run into in keeping and helping Lamont to keep his piano tuned with this very special tuning?
Well, it's interesting. I think the care that Lamont and his staff have recently put into the big Bosendorfer that they've been using for these concerts has sort of evolved quite beyond a certain expected point, in that not only has, well, when I started tuning the piano, we tuned the spinet first, and that was very difficult to tune because the strings are much shorter. You know, it's a different instrument, you know, really, than the kind of piano you're going to hear on the air later. And so it was really difficult to even get the idea that it was in tune, because the odd harmonics were very strong, you know. But then when we got the first Bosendorfer in Rome for the world premiere, that was a vast improvement. You know, that was a real instrument, albeit it was a baby grand, I believe, right?
Yeah, it's a parlor grand, right.
Mm-hmm. It was smaller, you know, than what was really required, but it was quite good. And so we played with that. And it tuned much easier in that it could be tuned. And then we began to hear acoustical phenomenon that reinforced the theory, I think, that Lamont had intuitively, or, you know, his original idea. I think we began to hear the realization of that. Oh, you know, it really does sound good when you get those fifths really perfect.
Mm-hmm.
And then anything you play besides that is enhanced by that. And, you know, interesting analogy can be drawn to Marian's work, where when you look at some of the lights, you know, there's this sort of new aura around things. I mean, you know, light is aura, but there's no explaining why there seems to be things that are shimmering around in the air, you know? Anyhow.
Well, one of the things that Lamont, you've mentioned repeatedly in various writings, is the fact that when the piano is properly tuned in just intonation, and again, we emphasize that means that the intervals that are being used are in small whole number ratios to each other, which are
not necessarily small, but practically
relatively small. which are, in fact, the ratios that occur in the natural overtone series. And a vibrating string, being a complex sound-producing mechanism, will produce many overtones when struck. That all of these things, finally, are in tune, quite literally, with each other, and some very magical acoustical phenomena develop. Now, you mentioned also that in this large, wonderful space that Marian described, that there have been times when, in performing this piece, you've been able to actually synchronize the rhythm, that is the rate at which you're pressing the keys, striking notes, the same notes or new notes, with these acoustical beats that are occurring with the actual frequencies produced, to produce this kind of shimmering cloud of sound that seems to sort of hang in the air. And this is a phenomenon that simply cannot take place with ordinary tuning in pianos, and probably even in ordinary concert halls, I wouldn't be surprised.
Well, I think that it... can take place in a variety of halls. We were able to achieve it in the Fabio Sargentini Gallery Lattico in Rome. We were able to achieve it at the world premiere in 1975 in New York, both of which Alex was the tuning assistant for. We achieved it in several spaces at Harrison Street, including the large space. But it definitely cannot be achieved with your equal tempered tuning. What happens is that integers beget integers. If you have intervals tuned in just intonation, every frequency can be represented as some whole number multiple in my tunings of some assumed lowest fundamental. And if you play the interval of 3 to 2, 3/2, a perfect fifth, you get a sum tone of 5 and difference tone of 1. If you play a perfect fourth, the interval of 4/3, you get a sum tone of 7 and a difference tone, again, of 1.
You should explain that those numbers are, again, integers.
And those numbers are, again, integers, and they're part of this series of integers, and they're harmonically related, so that no matter what you play together within this tuning, it produces these what are called combination tones, sum and difference tones, and second and third generation sum and difference tones, which go to make up what's called an envelope. Of tones, which are all sounding, you can hear them in your ears. They take place in your ear, especially. In addition to the harmonics, which are already extant in every string, so that you have an entire system of vibrations that is synchronized together, each reinforcing the other, making a whole that is greater than the sum of the parts. And consequently, when I play, since some of the intervals are tuned closely together and some of the harmonics are very close together, these produce what are known as beat frequencies, which acoustical beat frequencies, which are at, in some cases, at rates of speed, which you can hear very clearly. And since my piano technique is extremely fast, I am able to synchronize the rhythms of my fingers depressing the keys with the frequency of the sum and difference tones and other combination tones, this periodic composite waveform that is produced, thereby further reinforcing it and creating a system of resonances that goes between my fingers to what's happening in the air, in people's ears, into my ears, back to my fingers. And I think that this is probably the first time in the history of music that someone has synchronized rhythm with pitch in a way that is in real time. I know that people have done it electronically and contrived ways to make this happen, but here I actually improvise it in real time, I've always been interested in how does rhythm really relate? How does tempo really relate to pitch? What's it all about? I used to sit and listen to the drones in Dream House. You know, Dream House was perhaps my largest major work. the way the well-tuned piano got started, you know, Dream House got started in the 60s also. And it was the group that Alex sang in, my group, the Theater of Eternal Music, would perform in these Dream House, presentations. I would sing, Marian would sing, Alex would sing, John Hassell played trumpet, Terry Riley was singing in the group at one time, John Cale played viola, Tony Conrad violin, David Rosenboom was in the group for a while, Wayne Forrest on tuba. It was changing personnel over the years. Finally, we had 2 tons of electronic equipment that we were taking on the road with us and all of these people, and it was a lot of fun, and they were great performances. But one day, Fabio Sargentini came to my loft and he said, I want you to do a concert in Rome. And I said, oh, great, I'll do Dream House. And he said, no, we just did Dream House last year at the, you see, I have one problem in my music, which is I don't do little teeny tiny pieces and a new one today and a new one tomorrow and pop off another one for this commission. My goal is to achieve huge compositions, which are totally interwoven with themes, interwoven like a tapestry that can unfold in time and take 5 hours in one sitting.
They have open architectures.
Yeah, 3 to 5 hours in one sitting, but which in time really unfold. The performance you're going to hear today of the well-tuned piano, 5 hours, is not the complete work. It is a complete performance. There is more material in the well-tuned piano than I can play in one sitting. And this is something I was getting to earlier about the conditions for a live performance of the well-tuned piano and why it's so important to do in a radio broadcast, in my opinion, a tape that has been recorded in a live concert series. The tape we're going to hear today is the 4th concert in a series of 7 concerts in which I had 3 preview concerts before the ones that opened the series, so that I've evolved the work and achieved a point with the work that could never happen in the first time that I sit down at the station, let's say. If I were to have tried to do it here, we would have had to have had the piano on location for a month while we tuned it and got it ready. I would have been practicing here. Since my concert performances are so long, the shortest concert I ever did was I had the flu once in Rome and I only played for 3 hours continuous. It takes, although in the old days I used to play the work 2 or 3 times a week, as I've gotten older now that I'm 50, I've decided that the way to really do it is to play once a week. I play on Sunday evenings at 6 o'clock usually. And then the rest of the week I rest, and by about Wednesday, I'm starting to hear back the tape of the Sunday performance to think about what I did. And then Thursday and Friday, I practice. And Saturday, I just touch the keys to make sure my assistant tuner has got it in perfect shape. And Sunday, I play again. And since it's taken a month to set it up, let's say, I want to play the work at least 7-8 times to recoup my investment of time, energy, and to allow my love affair with the piano to evolve, so that really, what we're talking about to do a live concert series of the well-tuned piano is 2 to 3 months on location. And this is what I was getting to with Dream House. Dream House was going in the same direction. Fabio said, look, we can't afford to do another Dream House. We just did it last year. I said, okay, look, I'll let you play a tape of the well-tuned piano. It's this other work I'm developing. It's really great. He heard the tape. He loved it. He said, look, better than that, I've got a Bösendorfer available in Rome. Come and play the Bösendorfer. I said, okay, I'll give it a shot. I played it. It was an immediate success, so much so that Fabio decided to buy the piano. He had me sign it, made it available to me to play for the rest of my life. We took it to America in 75, did the American premiere. And then in 76, Radio Bremen provided me with the largest size Bösendorfer, the Imperial Grand, to tune. Heiner Friedrich of the Dio Art Foundation and Philippa came to that performance. They heard it. They loved it. They bought that piano. We sent it to the Bösendorfer factory in Vienna to have it totally customized, the first totally customized well-tuned piano. And that's the one we're going to hear today. really, this is the last concert series that I did at the Well-Tuned Piano at the DO Art Foundation at our 6 Harrison Street project in New York at our dream house, because the DO Art Foundation gradually had financial reversals. They were unable to continue the budget to do these big productions that I wanted to do, and finally they had to sell the building this last May, which was very unfortunate. However, we do hope through our foundation, the Mela Foundation, that we will again be able to continue our work. Eventually, we hope another dream house, other long-term installations, because to do the kind of work I want to do, it's really a necessity. It's very difficult for me to do a quote-unquote one-night stand. It's just not in the direction that I'm interested in going.
Let me jump in and ask our fifth guest, who has since joined us in the studio, who is Dan Wolf, editor of the magazine Zen Harmonicon. Come on in, Dan. Because I know some other people who are very fond of that magazine, namely people like Lou Harrison, who's always talking about it. A little free advertising for you there. Tell me, before we ask Lamont to give us a few more specific details about the structure of the performance of the particular performance of Well-Tuned Piano that we're going to hear, tell me a little bit about what your magazine does in the way of, I suppose, promoting just intonation is one of your goals. Is that true?
Well, I've recently taken over Zen Harmonicon from Dr. John Chalmers, who's based in Houston. And Zen Harmonicon is a broad-ranged journal of speculative music theory, basically tuning theory, different systems of tuning, and is not only biased toward just intonation, but other temperaments based on less rational bases. My personal interest is in just intonation and Lamont's work. Zen Harmonicon contains both scores and theoretical articles, and from time to time, more practical articles about equipment, new instruments.
Lamont also tells me that you're collecting material, and perhaps it won't be too long before we'll have a book to be able to put in our hands talking about some of Lamont's theories and further and more elaborate descriptions of his music that you're in the process of collecting.
Yeah. Lamont's career and music have been an obsession of mine for
You sure you can get this all in just one book? Yeah. I would think it'd be a small library in itself.
Fortunately, Lamont's work is very well documented. It's all the critical responses is readily available, and his theory that he postulates and extends to all his work is a theory of harmony that's entirely original. It's consistent, and with that consistent, can be presented in a really concise way.
We'll be looking forward to that. Lamont, let me ask you this in about the 9 or 10 minutes that we have left before we're going to have to start the tape. This particular performance of Well-Tuned Piano that we're going to hear is a relatively recent performance. And as you've mentioned over the years, the work has grown, it's become more elaborate, more complex, new material has been introduced. Can you give us a few guidelines or high points or reference points in this performance?
Yes.
Tell us a little bit about the internal structure of this particular performance.
The Well-Tuned Piano consists of major chordal areas. The big major chordal areas are the opening chord, then there's a transition to the magic chord, then there is a transition back toward the opening chord, but it becomes the pool, the shimmering pool. The pool retains one of the pitches from the magic chord. And sometimes we move into the area of the magic opening chord, which we do in this performance, and eventually into the magic harmonic rainforest chord. The magic harmonic rainforest chord is one of the big structures, the frequency structures of all subsections of the work can be thought of as subsets and intersecting sets of three inclusive sets of frequencies. The deep in the rainforest chord, the romantic chord, and the Elysian fields. The sets of frequencies in the deep in the rainforest chord and the romantic chord intersect with one common tone, and the sets of frequencies for the Elysian fields and the romantic chord intersect with six common tones. So it's hard to put that together in just a few minutes, but that's an exact way of stating it. I wrote that statement down just to read it off that way. But then from the harmonic rainforest chord, we will eventually make a transition. And this is one of the most evolved transitions, the transition to the romantic chord. The romantic chord is one of the oldest sections of the well-tuned piano. In fact, it predates the well-tuned piano. It's something that I play in Dorian, which I even used to play on normal pianos, but which then I made a very special tuning of for the well-tuned piano. And then from the romantic chord, we go to the at last the Elysian fields. Within each one of these sections, there are a number of themes. For instance, in the opening chord, the very first theme we hear is the theme of the dawn of eternal time. That theme dates, we think, back to around Rome in 74. And then we'd have the transition to the magic chord, and there we have the theme from the magic chord and various variations, the 9/8 variation, the 12/8 variation, the organum variation. Then we do the transition from the magic chord to the harmonic rainforest chord. And in the harmonic rainforest chord, we hear the goddess of the caverns under the pool, the sunlight filtering through the leaves, the harmonic opening chord, the harmonic rainforest chord, the deep in the rainforest chord, the magic opening chord, the pool, the shimmering pool reflecting the 288-147 premonition of the theme of the dawn of eternal time recalled in the 189-98 Lost Ancestral Lake region. The magic harmonic rainforest chord, the premonition of the theme of the lyre of Orpheus, the interlude of the wind and the waves, the fountain, and we discovered the fountain right in this concert series, which, let me say, when I sit down to play the well-tuned piano, not only do I play things that I've developed and evolved in the rehearsals, I play things that sometimes I have never played before. Sometimes a whole new theme, a whole new section will evolve because I tune myself in to some higher source and I let this flow through me. And it flows in the form that I've developed and through the practice that I have done. But I let myself be open to whatever information is transmitted through me. Then from the fountain, we will hear the deep pool, then the ethers churn, the dinosaurs dance, Young's Brontosaurus boogie, Young's Vosa Brontosaurus boogie. We follow the stream up into the foothills, the brook, sunshine in the old country, the transition from the magic harmonic rainforest chord to the romantic chord. This is a very evolved transition. It's developed many many themes. There's the chorale theme, transitional motifs from the harmonic rainforest chord, the simple sequence, the modern sequence, the classical sequence, the homage à Debussy sequence. Then we get to the Moonlight Sonata passage, which really leads us into the romantic chord. Once we get to the romantic chord, we hear the Bremen theme, the Bonn theme, the original romantic theme, the classical theme, the introduction to the ornamental return from the romantic chord, the ornamental return, the Valentine's Day chord, the gamelan theme, the harmonic romantic chord, the 189-98 Lost Ancestral Lake region, the ancestral boogie, the ancestral Bosa boogie, the Tamiar dream chord, Scheherazade, the flying carpet, the Elysian fields, recalling the theme of the dawn of eternal time in the Elysian fields, the lyre of Orpheus, recalling the theme of the dawn of eternal time in the 189-98 Lost Ancestral Lake region, the penultimate theme in four-part harmony and five-part harmony, and finally the ending.
You know, as you were reciting all of this, Lamont, I had this sort of vision 50 years from now, 100 years from now, 200 years from now, that all of the learned commentators on music will be preparing these things like they do for the Wagner Ring Cycle, where they have each theme associated with each character or each act of will or what have you. And I can see this now, that there will be many masters and PhD theses.
No doubt. About all this. No doubt the babies are being born, even right. as we speak,
even as we
to
speak.
Someday come to that conclusion that they have to analyze the piece, because I think in time people will realize how significant the work actually is, and then they will want to try to explain it. And our classical way of doing that is to take it apart and analyze it.
Mm-hmm.
So it will happen.
And there's a very interesting story that can be developed here. You know, back at the theme of the dawn of eternal time. In fact, Alex, after one performance, told me his ideas about he had put together the story. But coming from the theme of the dawn of eternal time to the magic chord, then the pool. The pool is the primeval pool, the pool where it all began, with the genes developing and coming out of this primeval ooze, and then the goddess of the caverns under the pool, and then finally you go through the deep in the rainforest chord, and eventually you get to the romantic chord with the classical theme and all of this. Finally, you reach the classical period. And finally, then you get to the Elysian fields with the lyre of Orpheus and so forth, and then to the ending. And it's a very exciting journey. This experience for me is one of the incredible experiences of my life, to play the well-tuned piano, to continue to work on it. When people ask me, what are you doing? You know, in Europe, they like to have a world premiere each time you come there. And I say, mm-hmm. I'm going to do the well-tuned piano. And they say, oh, but you just did the well-tuned piano. But it's made up of 60, 70 themes, and I'm always composing new themes. I'm not going to sit down and just for a few bucks, you know, I'm not a prostitute walking the streets. You can't just give me money and say, sit down and write a new piece, Lamont. I'm not going to do it. I'm going to compose the music that's coming out of me according to my inspiration. And I want to evolve this work, the well-tuned piano, just like I evolved Map of 49's Dream from the Tortoise's Dreams and Journeys. For many years, I'm interested in these huge interwoven structures in time, and you really cut yourself short. It's no shortcut if you sit down, if you're trying to do what I want to do, and just toss off commission after commission in order to earn a few bucks.
Let me ask you this. As you've so eloquently explained, the piece has evolved over a long period of time, has become much more complex and elaborate. Will it continue to evolve in the future? Do you see an end to this process?
Absolutely. It evolves each time I am commissioned to do a big concert series. It evolves a little bit in between. I recently am working with a synthesizer designed by a young man named David Rayner, and interfacing with the well-known Bob Bilecki. And I'm able to have more and more of the chords from the well-tuned piano accessible to my fingertips, and I'm making more and more chords for sound environments, and I am continuing to evolve the piece all the time, but it especially evolves when I get into a performance series, because then I do nothing else but think, live, dream, and perform the well-tuned piano.
Well, I think we've just about exhausted all of the main topics that we had laid out to cover today. We want to, of course, remind our listeners that this has been a conversation with composer and pianist Lamont Young, and we've been joined in the studio by his wife, visual artist Marian Zazeela, and two other people who have a more than passing interest, shall we say, in Lamont's music, namely Alex Dia and Dan Wolf. For those of you who may have tuned in a little bit late, we're going to be in just a few minutes starting an historic broadcast, the first here on the West Coast, of a complete performance of Lamont Young's well-tuned piano as part of this year's celebration of New Music America. And I think with that as a catch-up, let me remind you, you're listening to KPFK Los Angeles, 90.7 FM. And I'll let Lamont himself introduce the work.
So the title of this performance of the well-tuned piano is 8110, that's October 4th, 6:15:37 to 11:08 p.m. New York City. It is 4 hours and 52 minutes. Try to hear the entire thing. It takes place as a complete performance, but if you can't, hear what you can. Hear more next time. This performance was at our dream house at 6 Harrison Street in New York City.
And I'd like to thank you all for being with us today.